The Gulag Archipelago, Volume 3,
An Experiment in Literary Investigation,
by Aleksandr Solzhenitsyn,
read by Frederick Davidson.
A preface to the English translation. To those readers who have found the moral strength to overcome the darkness and suffering of the first two volumes, the third volume will disclose a space of freedom and struggle. The secret of this struggle is kept by the Soviet regime even more zealously than that of the torments and annihilation it inflicted upon millions of its victims. More than anything else, the communist regime fears the revelation of the fight which is conducted against it with a spiritual force unheard of and unknown to many countries in many periods of their history. The fighter's spiritual strength rises to the greatest height and to a supreme degree of tension when their situation is most helpless and the state system most ruthlessly destructive. The communist regime has not been overthrown in 60 years, not because there has not been any struggle against it from inside, not because people docilely surrendered to it, but because it is inhumanly strong, in a way as yet unimaginable to the West. In the world of concentration camps, corrupt as everything within the Soviet system, the struggle began, alas, it could not begin otherwise, by terrorist actions. Terrorism is a condemnable tool, but in this case it was generated by 40 years of unprecedented Soviet state terrorism, and this is a striking instance of evil generating evil. It shows that when evil assumes inhuman dimensions, it ends up by forcing people to use evil ways even to escape it. However, the concentration camp terrorism of the 50s, out of which heroic uprisings were born later on, was essentially different from the left-wing revolutionary terrorism, which is shaking the Western world in our days, in that young Western terrorists, saturated with boundless freedom, play with innocent people's lives and kill innocent people for the sake of their unclear purposes or in order to gain material advantages. Soviet camp terrorists in the 50s killed proved traitors and informers in defense of their right to breathe. However, there is no kind of terrorism that can be considered a pride of the 20th century. On the contrary, terrorism has made it into one of the most shameful centuries of human history. And there is no guarantee that the darkest abyss of terrorism already lies behind us. Part 5. Katorga. We shall turn the Siberia of Katorga, Siberia in shackles, into a Soviet socialist Siberia. Stalin. Chapter 1. The Doomed. Revolution is often rash in its generosity. It is in such a hurry to disown so much. Take the word katorga, for instance. Now, katorga is a good word, a word with some weight in it, nothing like the runtish abortion D-O-P-R or the pipsqueak I-T-L. Katorga descends from the judicial bench like the blade of a guillotine. Stops short of beheading the prisoner, but breaks his spine, shatters all hope there, and then in the courtroom. The word katorjane holds such terror that other prisoners think to themselves, these must be the real cutthroats. It is a cowardly but comfortable human failing to see yourself as not the worst of men, nor in the worst position. Katorjane were numbers. They are obviously beyond redemption. Nobody would pin a number on you or me. They will, though. You'll see. Stalin was very fond of old words. He never forgot that they can cement a state together for centuries. It was not to meet some proletarian need that he grafted on again words too hastily lopped off. Officer, general, director, supreme. And 26 years after the February Revolution had abolished katorga, Stalin reintroduced it. This was in April 1943, when he began to feel that he was no longer sliding downhill. For the home front, the first fruits of the people's victory at Stalingrad, were the decree on the militarization of the railroads, providing for trial of women and little boys by court-martial. And on the following day, April the 17th, the decree introducing the katorga and the gallows. The gallows is another fine old institution, much superior to a short, sharp pistol shot. It makes death a leisurely process, which can be exhibited in detail to a large crowd of people. Each subsequent victory drove fresh contingents of the doomed into katorga or to the gallows, first from the Kuban and the Don, then from the left bank Ukraine and the Kursk, Orel, and Smolensk regions. On the heels of the army came the tribunals, publicly hanging some people on the spot, dispatching others to the newly created katorga forced labor camps. The first of them, of course, was mine number 17 at Vorkuta. Those at Norilsk and Zhezhkazgan came soon after. Little attempt was made to conceal their purpose. The katorjane were to be done to death. These were undisguisedly murder camps. But in the Gulag tradition, murder was protracted so that the doomed would suffer longer and put a little work in before they died. They were housed in tents, 7 meters by 20, of the kind common in the north. Surrounded with boards and sprinkled with sawdust, the tent became a sort of flimsy hut. It was meant to hold 80 people if they were on bunk beds, or 100 on sleeping platforms. But katorjane were put into them 200 at a time. Yet there was no reduction of average living space, just a rational utilization of accommodation. The katorjane were put on a 12-hour working day with 2 shifts and no rest days, so that there were always 100 at work and 100 in the hut. At work, they were cordoned off by guards with dogs, beaten whenever anybody felt like it, urged on to greater efforts by Tommy guns. On their way back to the living area, their ranks might be raked with Tommy gun fire for no good reason, and the soldiers would not have to answer for the casualties. Even at a distance, a column of exhausted katorjane was easily identified. No ordinary prisoners dragged themselves so hopelessly, so painfully, along. Their 12 working hours were measured out in full to the last tedious minute. Those quarrying stone for road-making in the polar blizzards of Norilsk were allowed 10 minutes for a warm-up once in the course of a 12-hour shift. And then their 12-hour rest was wasted in the silliest way imaginable. Part of these 12 hours went into moving them from one camp area to another, parading them, searching them. Once in the living area, they were immediately taken into a tent, which was never ventilated, a windowless hut, and locked in. In winter, a foul, sour stench hung so heavy in the damp air that no one unused to it could endure it for 2 minutes. The living area was even less accessible to the katorjane than the camp work area. They were never allowed to go to the latrine, nor to the mess hut, nor to the medical section. All their needs were served by the latrine bucket and the feeding hatch. Such was Stalin's katorga as it took shape in 1943 to 1944. A combination of all that was worst in the camps with all that was worst in the prisons. We have Chekhov's word for it that the Tsarist katorga was much less inventive. The katorjane in the jail at Aleksandrovskaya, Sakhalin, could not only go out into the yard or to the latrine at all hours of the day and night, latrine buckets were not in use there at all, but at any time during the day could go into the town. Stalin, then, was the first to understand the word katorga in its original sense, a galley in which the rowers are shackled to their oars. Their 12 hours of rest also included inspections, morning and evening, no mere counting of heads, as with ordinary zeks, but a full and formal roll call at which each of 100 katorjane, twice in every 24 hours, had to reel off smartly his number, his abhorrent surname, forename, and patronymic, where and in what year he was born, under which article of the criminal code he was convicted and by whom, the length of his sentence and when it would expire, while the other 99, twice daily, listened to all this and suffered torments.
Then again, food was distributed twice in the course of these 12 hours. Mess tins were passed through the feeding hatch, and through the feeding hatch they were collected again. No katorjanin were permitted to work in the kitchens, nor to take around the food pails. All the serving was done by the thieves, and the more brazenly, the more ruthlessly they cheated the accursed katorjana, the better they lived themselves, and the more the camp bosses liked it. As always, when the 58s, politicals, were footing the bill, the interests of the NKVD and of the thieves coincided. According to the camp records, which were not meant to preserve for history the fact that political prisoners were also starved to death, they were entitled to supplementary miners' rations and bonus dishes, which were miserable enough even before three lots of thieves got at them. This was another lengthy procedure conducted through the feeding hatch. Names were called out one by one, and dishes exchanged for coupons. And when at last you were about to collapse onto the sleeping platform and fall asleep, the hatch would drop again. Once again, names were called, and they would start reissuing the same coupons for use the next day. Ordinary execs had none of this bother with coupons. The foreman took charge of them and handed them into the kitchen. So that, out of 12 leisure hours in the cell, barely 4 remained for undisturbed sleep. Then again, katorjana were, of course, paid no money, nor had they any right to receive parcels or letters. The memory of their former freedom must fade in their muddled, dully aching heads, till there was nothing left in the inscrutable polar night but work and barracks. The katorjana responded nicely to this treatment and quickly died. The first alphabet at Vorkuta, 28 letters, with numbers from 1 to 1,000 attached to each of them, the first 28,000 prisoners in Vorkuta all passed on to the earth within a year. We can only be surprised that it was not in a single month. When Chekhov was there, the whole convict population of Sakhalin was, how many would you think? 5,905. 6 letters of the alphabet would have been enough for all of them. Ekibastutz, as we knew it, was roughly as big, and Spassk very much bigger. The name Sakhalin strikes terror, yet it was really just one camp division. In Steplag alone, there were 12 complexes as big as that of Sakhalin, and there were 10 camps like Steplag. You can calculate how many Sakhalins we had. A train was sent to Cobalt Mine No. 25 at Norilsk to pick up ore, and some katorjana laid down in front of the locomotive to end it all quickly. A couple of dozen prisoners fled into the tundra in desperation. They were located by planes, shot, and their bodies stacked where the men lined up for work assignment would see them. At No. 2 mine, Vorkuta, there was a women's camp division. The women wore numbers on their backs and on their head scarves. They were employed on all underground jobs, and, yes, they even overfulfilled the plan. But I can already hear angry cries from my compatriots and contemporaries. Stop! Who are these people of whom you dare to speak? Yes, they were there to be destroyed, and rightly so. Why, these were traitors, polizei, burgomasters. They got what they asked for. Surely you are not sorry for them? If you are, of course, further criticism is outside the competence of literature and must be left to the organs. And the women there were German bedstraw. I hear women's voices crying. Am I exaggerating? It was our women who called other women German bedstraw, wasn't it? I could most easily answer in what is now the conventional fashion, by denouncing the cult. I could talk about a few untypical cases of people sent to Katorga, the 3 Komsomol girl volunteers, for instance, who went up in a fighter-bomber but were afraid to drop their bombs on the target, jettisoned them in open country, returned to base safely, and reported that they had carried out their mission. Later on, her Komsomol conscience began troubling one of them, and she told the Komsomol organizer of her air squadron, also a girl, who of course went straight to the special section. The 3 girls collected 20 years of katorga each. I could cry shame, to think that honest Soviet people like these were punished like criminals at the despot Stalin's whim. And I could wax indignant not so much at Stalin's high-handedness as about the fateful errors in the treatment of Komsomols and communists, now happily corrected.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.